Time now for our Sunday morning Q&A. Joining us this morning, Dr. Lillian Lowery, the State Superintendent of Schools. Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, you have been on the job here since July. You've been traveling the state. What have you learned about our area schools?
Well, as I knew coming in, their schools are amazing. As I visit the 24 jurisdictions, I find that each one has its own unique circumstances. Mm-hmm. A lot of good work really tailored to the students that they serve. Good things are happening.
Yeah, when you went through the 24 jurisdictions, you were able to see what discrepancies there were, where there's some weaknesses and where other schools needed to catch up.
Well, actually, because of the work that the districts have been doing around the third wave of reform, they are really collaborating really well. And so best practices are being spread among them. I find that where we all have opportunities for growth, they are sharing best practices and doing it together. So,
all right, let's talk a little bit about violence in schools. First day of school, Baltimore County, gun in the school, young man is shot. What are some of the things that you're doing to address violence in schools, and how did you sort of call your superintendents together after those incidents?
Well, I will begin by saying that Dr. Dance is just a phenomenal leader and did a great job at navigating through that very critical, difficult time. And of course, we send our best wishes to the student and his family and the other students who were impacted by that. The superintendents have plans for crises that are required each year. It certainly has compelled all of us to look more closely to what's in those plans and how we share across the state those things that work best, not only with the school districts, though. If one noticed the local jurisdiction, the county executive and the police department were very actively engaged with Dr. Dance in working through those. So I believe what we've learned is, of course, the school is the microcosm, and we have to make sure that we have great safety and security policies and practices in place, but it is bigger than just a school. We also learned through that we have to work very closely with our county officials.
So did you sort of send out a memo or say something to your superintendents about just review these?
I meet with the superintendents once a month, mm-hmm. and so after that happened, we had a monthly meeting. All 24 superintendents were at the table, and we had a really robust discussion about all of that happened, and Dr. Dance could share some of his circumstance mm-hmm. and how they responded and get best ideas from his colleagues.
Because right. It wasn't just Baltimore County.
Right.
We're seeing it in Anne Arundel County,
Absolutely.
Baltimore City.
Absolutely.
All right, well, we just had a major weather event with the hurricane. I'm sure we're going to have more. Is that something that's been on your radar and something you've been addressing with your superintendents about, you know, snow days and hurricane days and other weather days?
I was really amazed because this was my first climate exchange, if you will, here in the state of Maryland. And it is a well-oiled machine, MEMA. I mean, we were on the phone with the governor very often throughout this entire process. He was in contact with all of the local jurisdictions and the county officials. MEMA was just extraordinary. And we have staff at MSDE who are dedicated to making sure that we have contacted all 24 jurisdictions so that when we're reporting to the governor and his staff, we can update them on what's happening, what the needs are for the schools, what schools are going to be closed, what schools are going to be open. So we have pretty good protocols in place here in Maryland.
Let's shift to teachers a little bit. Teacher evaluations. Student growth now factors into that, and some teachers are saying this is just not fair.
Right, right. I think what we have to do more than any other work that I'm tasked with coming in is shift this conversation to the reason that we are engaged in this third wave of reform. We're engaged in this third wave of reform to ensure that our students have rigorous standards so that we know that when we talk about college and career ready, we can define across the state compared to other states in the nation what college and career readiness means. And so the conversation needs to be about how do we implement these conceptual standards so that our students have much more rigor earlier and that they are not just looking at regurgitating facts, but in English language arts, they're looking at technical reading and writing and how to use evidence-based practices to support what they're saying and writing. And on the math side, how they not only look for the right answer, but how they can conceptually explain how they derived those answers. So then we have the assessment to determine, did we implement well? Mm-hmm. and our students learning. So I believe as we walk through this, and this year is a field test year, so we can really assess what works best to ensure that we're being fair to teachers and leaders as we walk through this process, we will get to a better place. It really is about the curriculum. The assessment is a lagging indicator to determine if we implement it well and if students are learning.
And in defense of teachers,
right.
They're going to say we're more than just teachers. Mm-hmm. And when it comes to assessments, we have to play the role of parent many times, disciplinarian many times. So they do more than just that. So how do you factor in that into their jobs?
I believe with all my heart, and having been a teacher for many years, if we didn't do all of those things, we wouldn't be effective anyway. If we don't build relationship with students, take them where they are, whoever walks through the door in public schools, they have to be accepted because that's what public schools are all about. And our teachers are phenomenal at going above and beyond the call of duty to make sure that they're well cared for, that they feel safe and secure. And without that kind of relationship, the learning isn't going to take place mm-hmm. anyway. We have to listen to our teachers as we go through this field test year. We have to listen to our leaders as we go through this field test year and make sure that what we're implementing is done with all of those considerations that you mentioned.
So you're saying you're committed to an open dialogue?
Absolutely.
All right.
Absolutely.
Dr. Lowery, thanks so much for
coming. Thank you. I really appreciate it.
And don't go away. We'll be right back.